particularly in the last week. So let's talk about the elephant in the room, the outage.
Okay.
What happened?
Well, I pressed the wrong button.
She really is the queen of Facebook.
She daisy.
She pressed the wrong button and everything went out for a second.
No, so this was the longest outage, about 10 hours, not only Facebook, but also Instagram, as many folks know. And 10 hours for a lot of people, who knows? They probably won't ever really necessarily let us know. My guess is in the millions and across not just the US, but worldwide. And so they put it down to server reconfiguration. I have my doubts. We'll probably never know, Sunny. It was something going on behind the scenes, and there'd been a lot of turmoil and change. And of course, it was really odd to me that very next day was when Chris Cox officially made his resignation known, you know, a long time as chief product officer. So there's a lot of change. And the reason Chris gave his notice, apparently was going to be leaving for about 2 years, stuck around to help him navigate the difficult waters, but he was basically did not agree or does not agree with Zuck's new direction to go on this whole privacy-focused.
Well, let's talk about that, the new direction with the privacy focus, because obviously that was big in the news earlier this year.
Totally,
so
yeah.
What does that mean for us?
For us as marketers?
Us as marketers, yeah, what does that mean?
So the way in which we reach our audience is going to start shifting. Eventually we will have a version of Facebook without a newsfeed. Mm-hmm. Mike Stelzner was just talking about his keynote upstairs. I'll talk about it a little more in mine tomorrow. But it's Zuckerberg, I have many speculations and many theories and many actual facts about why they've made this move. And I'm going to talk about that tomorrow. But a sneak preview is certainly one aspect is this interoperability, where private messaging is surpassing. Private messaging, private messaging surpassed social networks in terms of users back in 2014.
How many of you are using private messages on a daily basis here? Raise your hands or at home, you can let us know in the comments. Yeah, it's huge.
Yeah,
it's a huge part of business now.
And so it was back in January, I think it was, that Facebook announced they're going to integrate Facebook Messenger, WhatsApp, which of course owned by Facebook, and Instagram Direct, the messaging portion of Instagram. Not like all those three apps or functions are going to fuse and become one giant app, although they would like to be more like WeChat.
Yeah.
But the three of them will be able to interact and talk to one another real easily. That's one aspect. Another aspect of going more privacy-focused is to diminish the spread of fake news and viral memes that just really impact people's well-being on a negative basis.
Yeah.
And also bringing out encryption. Because if they have there's fully encrypted end-to-end on WhatsApp, if they bring out encryption to Messenger and then also Instagram Direct, then nobody can read our messages. Now, I've got to tell you, friends, that I was like, yeah, encryption, we all got encryption's the way to go. And I started reading some counter opinions. And this is where actually Chris Cox and Zuck did not agree. And there's all kinds of heinous things that can happen when messages cannot be read by AI, for example, to strip out and prevent and stop awful things happening when because there's things like that have happened with WhatsApp, for example. And so there's arguments for both sides. And really, we as marketers just have to be paying attention to the signals. And one signal, as certainly as we just talked about, Chris Cox leaving, and also Chris, the head of WhatsApp as well, on the same day, is leaving. So there's something afoot that us marketers need to pay close attention to.
Well, it feels very unnerving right now. I don't know if anybody else here is a little bit overwhelmed by Facebook at the moment, but if you are, raise your hand.
Yeah, totally.
Which is why I think your keynote will be back tomorrow.
Yes.
But I mean, I'm a YouTuber, and YouTube's my jam, so I'm not as well-versed in Facebook. But when you say, or when Michael Stelzner says there might not be a newsfeed on Facebook, it's a slight bit of panic for advertisers and marketers and even the everyday person who's using it in a personal sense. How is that going to impact ads being seen by your audience, reach, all those things?
Yeah, so reach will be a very different thing. And there's three main areas that you'll want to get those eyeballs on, both organic and paid content. And one is certainly stories. And stories, just the concept of stories, I believe, will be woven into other aspects of all the Facebook family of apps. So So the concept of ephemeral content disappearing, yes. It's only there for 24 hours and it's gone. Zuck's even talking about having maybe at some point we could have disappearing messages, disappearing posts. Then it's the lack of permanence that will have people feel more confident and comfortable to share more openly.
With attention being the greatest currency at that point.
Indeed.
Really.
Right, yeah. Right. So micro content, people just tap and swipe real easy. The second is certainly video, so doing more, having like video in-stream ads, pre-roll, mid-roll, whatever. Obviously YouTube's done that for years.
Yeah.
And it's taken a little while to catch on Facebook, but it definitely will be more so on Facebook. And then the third area is certainly groups. So groups could have its own feed. Groups, ads are coming to groups, the boost button's coming to groups. They've been testing that for a while. But Facebook's been really strongly pushing groups for about 2 years now and slowly adding more and more features, especially like the ability to have a page create a group and link it. Pages can even join groups now, so long as the admin allows that. And so if we start to just kind of put our heads around, well, gosh, without a news feed, you got stories, you got video, you got groups, you got private messaging, you got small chat groups, doing chat bots, things like that.
Well, and it kind of just reaffirms what we all know to be true here, but what sometimes is a little bit difficult to execute on, which is relationships are going to just become more and more important with your community. So maybe not these mass audiences, but maybe deeper rooted relationships that are actually going to push the needle for businesses, which oftentimes can get lost. It's kind of like, how many followers do you have and how fast can we grow? Instead, it's how deep can we go with the audience?
I love that, Sunny. I'm so glad you said that, because like for the longest time, 12 years now, I've had this saying that content is king, but engagement is queen, and she rules the house. Mm. Now, it's not that, and this is a little sneak of my keynote tomorrow, it's not engagement, it's just, oh, you know, double tap, and like, and ha-ha, and whatever, and just kind of like, that's a good start. I'm not diminishing that, it's a good start, but engagement, like you just said, is the depth. People are craving depth. People want to feel seen and heard and acknowledged by businesses and brands.
Absolutely.
Too. They want to know that they matter and they're not just a number, they're a follower. And you're right, the vanity metrics is going away. It's who cares how many fans you are? Even like reach can be a vanity metric. What you're trying to accomplish is real measurable business results, tracing it all the way through the customer journey to ROI. And you get to do that in your own unique way. Definitely based on relationships and having people belong to meaningful communities.
I love it. And with all of these changes coming to Facebook, you're working with their blueprint team, which is really exciting. So tell us a little bit about that and how you're helping to educate all of us on how to use Facebook properly in the coming years.
So Facebook has a blueprint. If you don't know, you guys can Google it. Facebook blueprint is all their free education. And then they have certification courses and you have to pay to get the actual certification. And what they've been doing predominantly is courses based around their platform. And now they're going to be expanding that. I can't say too much about it just yet. I'm under NDA. But there will be a new course coming in June. It will be a little bit more beyond just the Facebook skills. What's awesome about it, though, is that they're helping business. They're helping like people entering the job market or basically wanting to hone their skills and become proficient at starting and or growing a business. And what I've been able to bring to the table is really that user perspective, that business perspective, and not just the Facebook perspective.
Well, and who would have thought? I mean, honestly, when Facebook first came out, who would have thought that we'd be at this point where it would be something that you kind of needed to have as prerequisite to know how to use it in your job? So it's really exciting, and it's what makes conferences like this so exciting. And for all of you to be able to be here and learn from people like Mari, so make sure you go and see your keynote tomorrow so you get everything you need to know about all the changes happening on Facebook so you're well-versed in them. It's going to be a great keynote. We're looking forward to it. And up next, we're switching a little bit. We're going to head from Facebook over to maybe perhaps the king of YouTube, dare I say. Joel Kahn, let us know who's coming up next.
You dare say.
I dare say.
Thank you.
Hey, give it up for Mari Smith.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Mari, no matter what anybody says, you are an OG.
Open graph.
Exactly. Fantastic. Hey, how about that keynote with Mike Stelzner
this
morning?
That was great.
Right? Incredible data and understanding the future of where social media is going. Got an incredible guest for you right now. He is really, truly one of the kings of YouTube. When I tell you these numbers about what this man has accomplished, there should be a collective gasp. So here I go. He has generated over 41 billion video views on YouTube. He's helped 21 YouTube channels start from nothing and get a million subscribers each. He is has the number one crowdfunding media project ever. His name, Mr. Daryl Eaves. Please welcome him. Daryl, come on out. Come on in, brother. Have a seat. Come into my office. 41 million billion.
Billion, yes. That was really loud.
Like Dr. Evil. 41
billion.
Billion views. That's astronomical. I mean, if we had 41 million, that would be huge. I don't get 41, period.
You've had more than 41.
Well, to some of them, I don't. I have not cracked the YouTube code, and I've been on since 2006.
Yeah.
But that's because I'm not following what you're teaching.
That's probably true.
That it is. Okay, so you've kind of made big news lately by doing something that nobody has ever done for a media project.
Yeah.
You're creating a TV show that is a biblical show. It's based on the life of Jesus and the apostles.
Yeah.
And you've got plans for a 7-season. I mean, this project is huge. Like this is like House of Cards, but without the weirdness.
It's so true. So it's just not me. Like, we have a team. I'm just a small wheel in the cog, you know, that's there. But we have amazing people working on it. But our goal was to disrupt the world. And part of it is, and this is where getting the 41 billion video views comes into play. But there's a certain crowd that want a certain type of content. And what happens when we adjust to, you know, please the producers or the people that are paying for it, or we take things out that shouldn't be taken out, or we put things in that shouldn't be taken in, that we're really diluting the video content of what it's meant to be and how it can really affect someone.
Yeah, that's one of the biggest struggles, right, for content creators when they sell their project
right
to somebody else. It's like, it's not true to my artistic vision.
Exactly. And that's the whole thing. And so one of my partners, Dallas Jenkins, is one of the most creative people that I've ever come across, and he has a vision where he wants to be. So, you know, myself and the other partners that are involved, like, I'm really good at marketing and I'm really good at getting eyeballs on things. And so, you know, we work together as a team to really be, you know, find ways to get that message out. But what we wanted to do is figure out a way to crowdfund it. And you're familiar with crowdfunding, of course.
Heard of it. It,
crowdfunding is really powerful because you can find an audience that really would really resonate with that type of content. They could become your social army and then promote it for you as well. The only difference is I feel like crowdfunding is broken because you get a T-shirt or a slap on the back, sometimes a product if they deliver on that. And so we wanted to do it differently. So going and working with VidAngel Studios, who are our distribution partners for SVOD, we went through and got approval with the Securities Exchange Commission to actually take public money. And so as the people
say that again, just because I really want that to land. If anybody is in financial services and has ever dealt with the Securities and Exchange Commission, you're talking about one of the most difficult agencies to deal with.
It's definitely very difficult to do it. But what we were able to do, we were the first film and television project to be approved to receive public money. And basically what we were able to do is when people would invest in our project, they became our partners in pulling this off.
So they don't just get a credit at the end.
No.
Or the T-shirt or the pat on the back.
Yeah, it's whatever they contributed to go to the show, they're going to get a return on that. As the show succeeds, they're able to succeed as well.
Okay, so you did this crowdfunding and you raised an astronomical amount
of money. Well, our goal was to be the number one crowdfunded project of all time. And at that time, Mystery Science Theater 3000 and Veronica Mars were really neck and neck at 5.7 million. So our goal was to smash it. So we're just shy of $11 million that we raised. So,
dude, high five. $11 million. You didn't just smash it. You obliterated
it. It's good. And I think this is a message for everyone. It's just like there are people out there wanting to consume content, and they're passionate about it. And if you can get them seeing your vision, they'll be your best advocates. They'll be the ones that will actually get people to watch that content for you. And so that social army is like a huge component of really getting those views that you need and exposure that you want to do.
Yeah, let's put some bullet points on this, some takeaways, because there's got to be people watching and like, oh, I've got a project.
Yeah.
And I want to think outside, you know, the traditional ways of doing this. What are the things that you learned along the way in this Kickstarter that you can go, this is something that anybody could apply?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is middlemen take too much money. Mm-hmm. And like, if we can go direct to consumer, direct to viewer, that's going to win every single time. Because I mean, the way that the internet and how social's all connected right now, you can get to the right place, the right person at the right time with the right messaging, and you can test it out. And these audiences that you can develop and procure, and you can go find similar individuals out there that would be interested in it. And then it's just a paid model of saying, look, we'll pay to get that exposure, and then we'll have so much organic reach that come from it, and it will just kind of start snowballing.
Okay, but when you're talking about no middlemen, does that mean that you're not going to be dealing with the traditional streaming services? Is Netflix want to buy this, or so, Amazon? Or
so I like what I believe, and where I think the industry's going is we do have a distribution partner for what they call SVOD, so subscription video on demand.
Okay.
And it's VidAngel Studios, and we love VidAngel. We love what they're trying to do as well. However, we have just a small exclusivity window, and after that, we want to go direct to consumer. We want to just get in front of many eyeballs as we possibly can. So it will be on Amazon, but it'll be a purchase product, you know, or they can buy DVD, Blu-rays, for people that still actually do
what is that?
I don't even know what those things are.
I got one of them, they're VCRs.
Yeah.
Can I get it on a Betamax?
I do believe the model where things are going is people just want to consume what they want to consume, when they want to consume it, and it's not necessarily about platforms anymore. I think platforms, right now, everyone's trying to be the next subscription service. But I think where it's going to be is like content will sell its own, and it will be distributed through multiple platforms.
Okay, so you're taking a rebel approach to this.
Absolutely.
You're kind of a marketing rebel even, like our friend Mark Schaefer would say, who will be appearing shortly. Do you think that there's going to be a pivot in distribution for all? In other words, is Netflix, Amazon Prime, Hulu, are they going to have a couple decades on top, or do you see a pivot coming sooner than later with independent distribution?
So I watch really closely the upcoming generation, because that's going to tell you where things are going to go. Because like MySpace, it was written on the wall that they were going to die because of the upcoming generation just didn't want anything to do with it. And so the new generation...
Wait, MySpace is dead?
It is dead, by the way. Oh. I know that you still have your
Tom,
account.
Why?
But no, it's like getting that upcoming generation. And so Generation Z is an interesting type of generation. Like they consume more content than any other generation. Like 98% of them watch YouTube daily, you know, and they are consuming Netflix, but Netflix's biggest competitor isn't HBO. What they're really worried about is Epic Games, Fortnite, because it's taking away their time and stuff. And I truly believe that generation is so integrated with video games, and I think it's going to be really diluted over time of just getting their attention, because they just do not care to go to movies. They don't care to see the latest show unless they can see it on their small moldable device.
You know, it used to be if you spent an hour and a half watching a film, you were dedicating a chunk of time.
Right.
These kids in Generation Z, they'll watch hours of somebody else playing a game.
Absolutely. Yeah, the Let's Play, it's crazy where things are going, but the way that we're entertained, the way that we find value, is different generation from generation, and so we got to pay close attention to that market and where they're going, and I can tell you they're not on Facebook. That's why Facebook bought Instagram, because they're on Instagram, they're on Snapchat, they're on TikTok. I would encourage everyone to look at TikTok, because that's probably, it will be the number one app this year.
Really?
For sure.
And that's formerly Musical.ly, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So all the videos that this old middle-aged guy did that, you know, nobody wanted to watch are now on TikTok?
That is so true. No.
Which, that I'm an old middle-aged guy or nobody wants to watch?
Yeah, it's not going
to
happen.
Ow. My heart.
That's it hurts.
Let's talk just a little bit, if you could summarize the project itself. What's it called and what's it about?
Thank you. So it's The Chosen, and it's the first ever multi-season TV show about the life of Jesus Christ, which is really cool. I'm passionate. I'm religious. But what's really cool is we had 16,000 partners that were able to fund the project. And our model's this, is we're going to give it away for free, that first episode, and then we have a paid model after that. And it's really, really interesting. We did that earlier with a concept pilot to raise the money. It was a 19-minute video we put on Facebook for free, and we had just shy of 40 million video views on that one, and viewed all over the world. And it was able to funnel people in to find out about the project, and we found the people that were passionate like us that wanted to see that type of content.
Super exciting, and hope you guys at home will check this out. There's a game called
Oh Dear,
What Do You Meme? And I'm just gonna pull this top card for you right here. It's this guy, if we can get a tight shot on the squirrel, the excited squirrel right here. And some of these can be a little out there, so I'm not gonna hold the card. And I'm just gonna pull three of them here. Oh, this one's good. And this one's good, and this one's good. Okay, so there's the meme, and here are the three that you're gonna decide that this is. When you remember what you looked like in sixth grade, when you realize you peaked in high school, or when you're trying to lose weight but gain 3 pounds every time you smell a cookie.
That is it.
That's the one right there.
That is it.
Right there. Daryl Eves.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Daryl. Appreciate it, brother. Wow, what a great project. Amazing stuff. And $11 million crowdfunding. Sonny.
$11 million. Is my mic on?
You're always on, Sonny.
$11 million. That's wild.
Yeah.
Really, really crazy. I'm very excited for our next guest, too. I think it's just constant excitement here today. How's everyone feeling? There's so many of you here. It's really awesome.
I'm feeling good. I'm feeling so good. I'm going to leave you on the stage
now. I don't know if that's a real song or not, but thank you, Joel, for that. And a wonderful interview. So next up, one of my favorite people who's at this conference every year. She makes my day every time around. So please welcome to the stage, perhaps the queen of Instagram, Sophie Zimmerman. Let's give it up.
Sorry.
Yay! Are you living or storying?
Totally storying.
Okay, everyone say hi out there. Say hi!
Wait, let's get it. Let's get it. We gotta get it.
Of course we do.
We gotta get
Stand
it.
Stand by.
Hold on.
Stand by.
One more time.
Ready? 1, 2, 3. Woo! You guys, we practiced this a little louder now. Come on.
All right, one more time. Take two.
Take two.
It's going to be worth it, I promise.
One more practice round. Louder. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3.
Ready?
Woo! All right, perfect. We're still working on it, guys. We're still working on it. Going to get more. I know it's early. Hey, over here.
Oh. I thought we were sitting over there. Okay, this is actually better
This
for
is
me.
Better, right?
Wait,
a little
okay.
higher up.
Okay.
Perfect.
It's
okay.
Perfect. And we look very springy.
We're very springy. We're very bright. This is going to be a very bright interview with lots of great takeaways for all of you about Instagram. So Instagram is my second favorite platform compared to YouTube. I love Instagram. I'm on it every day. I use stories every single day. And you have created this wonderful methodology around Instagram called the Four Neighborhoods.
Yes.
Let's dive into this.
So the Four Neighborhoods, essentially, thank you, Instagram, for always updating and giving us opportunities to create content in different neighborhoods. So the first is the feed.
Love it.
Which is the place where it, typically is that digital magazine look and feel, chronologically, scroll back, where people can check you out. It's kind of like a resume, if you will, of your content.
Yep.
And then there's stories, and it's my favorite place too.
I love stories.
Love
them.
And that's what I'm talking about today at 11:30. So anyone in the room that wants to learn more about Instagram stories, I hope to see you there. But stories are awesome, and we can probably talk for hours about stories.
Yeah.
But then there's IGTV, and I'm really thankful that Instagram just updated that a couple weeks ago with being able to share in the feed for 1 minute. I just did my first IGTV this morning that will be in the feed soon.
Awesome.
Have you done that yet?
I haven't tested this out yet.
Okay, so
this is why I'm here, to learn new things.
So anyone in the audience test IGTV in the feed yet? A few
yes.
of you?
Yes.
Okay,
awesome.
So I think this is really a really exciting update.
Okay.
And then Instagram Live. And I go live to promote free content, and I have a strategy around live, and I'm not sure You do go live, but
I do.
Is it during promotion or is it to
mostly during promotion?
YouTube?
But a lot of like, it's the same. It's similar methodology in the sense where I'm all about distribution. And
right,
I think that's
right.
the missing key for a lot of people when it comes to social media and why they're feeling like you're not getting enough engagement or views or whatever else it might be. It's because you're probably not distributing it enough. And the
right.
best way to distribute it is that live feature.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. So do you want me to break that down a little
yes,
bit?
Please
okay.
do.
So just for all of you that are wondering, how can I use Instagram Live for my business? I want to give you some insight on what we do every week. So every week we create a YouTube video.
Yes.
Thanks to this woman over here. Our channel is rocking. And we then distribute that to Sunny's point in the feed with a trailer, an Instagram trailer driving traffic to that YouTube video. And we within, you know, we want engagement over on YouTube for 24 hours.
Yes,
on
ma'am.
You know,
can you tell that Susan through my program?
And we really have broken down how to do that very well. Our videos are getting like over 1,000 views
it's
in
so
a day.
Good.
Like, it's awesome. So we're driving traffic to YouTube, and then at night on Instagram Live, I go live and talk about that free content. And this is where a lot of people struggle, I think, on Instagram with the content creation. And you've been doing this forever and talking about this forever, Sunny, is like, you've got to be sharing free content for like 6 months before you start selling something and saying that you're the go-to person in that niche so that people can build that trust and see that you walk the talk. And I think by doing Instagram Live and talking about the content that you've already spent so much time creating, but giving it a different spin, a different point of view. And for me, I always talk about something that I don't talk about anywhere else. And I teach something so that people will want to come back every single time we go live. So we've cultivated this really great audience that shows up. And more importantly, you can bring in guests. You can collaborate with other businesses and other brands, and you can get them on your live broadcast. And when they're live, you can ask, because call to actions are everything. And yes, I'm that Boston chick that has, like, you gotta tell people what you want them
yes.
to do, right?
Yes, you gotta demand
and so
it a little.
On a live Instagram, you can ask them to tap that airplane icon and to invite their friends onto that live broadcast. So not only are you amplifying, promoting, and broadcasting your free content, you're in front of potentially a completely new audience. So that is, like, those four areas have been the four neighborhoods, Subi's, are where we have created content. But I'm not saying that you need to. You need to do what's best for you, especially if you're new to Instagram. You don't need to be doing all the neighborhoods like Sunny and I do. We both have a team that supports those efforts. But understanding where your target audience is and where they're consuming your content is so important. And Instagram is now showing us a lot of metrics for that.
It absolutely is. And I think a starting ground, I mean, if you are fairly new to Instagram, I think a great starting place is stories.
Oh, for sure.
Because it gets you warmed up to the platform and allows you to create content without it having to be so highly produced as some of the stuff that's mm-hmm. gonna be in the feed.
Yeah.
So those are the four neighborhoods. Now let's talk about getting real personal. And I just talked about this with Mari Smith, but
yeah.
relationships really are everything in social media. That's not news, and we've all
right.
heard that sentence before. But I do think that we've gone through a bit of an era where it's all about the vanity metrics. And yes, those are cute, but they don't really mean anything if you don't have real relationships. So I'm a
right.
huge fan of DMs on Instagram.
Yes.
I do voice notes left, right, and center on DMs to people. I enjoy them so much. I think DMs are a wonderful thing. And you have a really great sort of analogy for what the DMs
right.
really are.
So I think Instagram DMs are like inviting people over for coffee and cookies or fruit or whatever it is that you want to have at your house and getting to know one person. And this is the intimacy of a conversation. This is the opportunity of Instagram. This is why I love the Instagram direct messages and stories as a whole, because you can lead, you can leave amazing messages to people. Sunny likes to do the voice, right?
Love them. Yeah.
The voice messaging. I actually do a video response. Anyone here in the audience ever receive a video response from me? A couple people?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I believe that people want to be seen, they want to be heard, and they want to be talked to like this.
Yes.
The vanity metrics mean nothing. It's the relationships. And I always say it's the conversations, because the conversations lead to opportunities that ultimately can lead to a conversion. I don't love that word, but it's like making money.
Yeah.
Currency.
Plain and simple. Yeah.
You know, it's like those, and there's so many case studies and ways that we have used it strategically, especially now with Quick Reply.
Yeah.
Do you use Quick Reply?
I don't really. So let's tap into that.
All right. So anybody in the audience use Quick Reply in the Instagram DMs?
A few. This is good. This is
so we have a great YouTube video. Quick Reply, Subi Zimmerman, to get the whole lowdown on it. But real quickly, you can create text expanders based on commonly asked questions, which I get a lot.
Brilliant.
And so you can only have, I think, 10, so you might need to rotate those. So when someone asks me, where should I start on Instagram, I just type guide and it auto-populates.
Brilliant.
And so what I want to caution you here with is don't have these sound salesy. Use emojis, like I wave with a hand emoji and I sign it with the heart and the B emoji to add the personal, you know, the personalization to that quick reply. But if you're getting asked the same questions, and I don't know about your DMs, but hundreds a day,
yep,
right?
Absolutely.
You want to be efficient and effective and save time, and you want to do some of the tactics that we're talking about with the voice and the video. But for those of you that don't have time to be in the app responding to all of that, create a link to your best YouTube video, create a link to your best blog, and send it to them based on their question, and that builds that relationship.
And I think it's all about doing like the not so sexy work when it comes to social media, especially on Instagram. And I know that's something that I get asked all the time is like, how do you really start to build a following? How do you really increase your engagement? And the not so sexy work is being in those DMs every single day. It's responding to people with videos and voice notes, and we're both doing that. And that's where you really deepen the relationship. But in 2019, we have 40 seconds.
Okay,
so it's a little difficult. What is the best way for people to start really harvesting a community on Instagram?
I think stories. I absolutely think stories, and stories that lead to the DM, and engaging stories. Stories that actually aren't noise, but give value and take people to a conversation using those interactive stickers, which I'm going to be talking all about today, is how to get engaged Instagram stories so they do go to the DM, so you can have those conversations. And you can nurture those relationships.
You really are a master marketer. You plugged your session twice in this one sitting. I love it. Let's give it up for Sue.
All right, thank you guys.
So much.
That was good.
That was awesome. All right, Joel, who do we have coming up next?
See you later, honey. Thank
come
you.
Here, you.
Oh, I'm coming over with you? Okay.
Come here. I want you to, like, hey,
okay.
Sue.
Oh, me or her?
No, you, let's both come over. Yeah.
Come here. Come here. So here's... Let's get a shot there. It is the fat kitty who's super lazy. Grab a few cards over there because Sue needs to play
this. All
right,
I'm playing a game.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's what do you meme? Just look through a few of them and
pick the one that you think
this should be. Those of you watching
at
home,
I'm gonna read a few out loud. And you guys are gonna help us pick. Okay.
I'm not gonna finish what I said right now because Sunny's talking.
Can you see the picture, you guys? Yeah. Everybody, give me a yes if you can. No, you can't? Okay, well, it's a cat.
It's a cat.
Well,
now you know.
It's a cat.
For the tall people.
Okay. So here are your options of what this meme should be. When you're ordering a pizza and your broke friend screams, get wings too. When your lasagna sounds like World War II in the microwave but comes out cold. When you eat peanut butter too fast and regret ever being born.
I like that one.
When you go to the bathroom during hibachi and miss the onion volcano. When you gotta pay taxes, but all school taught you is how to calculate the circumference of a parallelogram. And when all your classmates are eating Lunchables, but your mom packed you organic cottage cheese and baby carrots.
Oh my gosh,
that's the one right there. I like that.
Sue B, give her a hand.
There we go.
All right.
Thanks, Sue.
That was fun.
You're the best.
Thank you, guys.
You're Insta awesome.
Insta awesome.
Okay, here. Woo, there it is.
Thank you.
Like that.
Got it.
Might hurt somebody with that. Don't forget, if you are watching at home, to please let us know you're watching by reacting with thumbs up or
Hi.
Smiley face or hearts. Don't do the angry face. We don't like that. And comment so that we know what you're up to. And then share it. And usually I have somebody to do the dance with, but I'll solo. Like, comment, share. Thanks, Sunny, leaving me to do the dance all by myself like that. Got a lot more great content coming your way. And right now, there's somebody lurking in the wings. And wait, not yet. Not, you're scaring me. He's spooky. This gentleman is a prolific author. He is a professor. And he is the author of multiple best-selling, he can't wait to be here, multiple best-selling books, including The Content Code, Known, and the brand new Marketing Rebellion. Please welcome Mark Schaefer. You couldn't wait, could you?
What did I miss here?
You missed that one. Here, we'll start with the game instead. Here, take this one. Show them what you got. It's the girl that's, well, I'm not gonna put any captions on it. Here, I think this is actually, read that one. I think that's her.
When he apologizes, but you still have some more arguing to do.
Right? I think that's it.
Well, first we need to make this official.
What are we doing?
I dub thee a marketing rebel.
Oh, nice. Very cool. If you haven't read Mark's new book yet, everybody I'm talking to is saying it's amazing.
Thank you.
Marketing rebel. What does that mean? Like, define that, distill it down to its simplest core.
Well, it was really, really difficult naming this book.
You tried Bob. You tried Patrick.
Joel.
Yeah.
Eliminated that immediately.
Yeah, thanks.
But when I started thinking about what's going on in our world today, what I started to find through my research is that marketing, it just doesn't work like it used to. And what I found is a lot of our marketing departments are sort of like chunking out content and working on social media like we've done for the last few years. And when you look up and when you see where the world is, the customers have moved away from us. That's what I'm going to be talking about in my speech tomorrow. I'll be giving the closing keynote. Hope you all can come.
Of course, and they're going to be there.
Yeah, it's going to be.
You're crazy if you miss it.
It's going to be scintillating.
Yeah.
And so, when I thought about it, there was literally a moment when I was looking at this research that I thought, I don't know what it means to be a marketer today. I literally sort of gasped to think, you know, so much has changed in our world, and a lot of the foundational things I held on to as a marketer for more than 30 years, they just don't work anymore. And we need to wake up. I think many marketers, marketing departments are asleep, and they don't know they're asleep. And so the purpose of this book, Marketing Rebellion, is to like level set and say, here's where the world is, let's adopt a new mindset and move on.
So here's my question then, what happened that caused this shift?
Well, a couple of things happened, but I think the most powerful thing is that we have technology-enabled, hyper-empowered consumers. So when you and I were growing up in business, we're growing up
we
in business.
We had to walk through the snow.
And we loved it.
To get
two
internet
miles
connection.
To school. And we loved it.
And remember, we would dial in on the modem.
Beep, boop, boop, beep, boop, boop. That was the sound of excitement, baby.
I totally distracted you.
Yeah. Where am I? San Diego. So I'm back. We have hyper-empowered consumers. And, you know, back when I was starting out in business, we sort of controlled the message, and the customers to know about us and learn about our products and services, they depended on our advertising, they depended on our marketing messaging. That was before social media and the internet.
So Coke said, we're the real thing.
We're the real thing.
Believe
it. And they were the real thing. But today we don't even see those stories anymore. Many consumers today are unreachable. So you think about, you know, I watch more television than I've ever watched in my life. I don't see ads. It's all on Netflix or Amazon. I listen to the radio a lot, but I never hear ads. It's all on Spotify. So consumers are now connecting to each other, and our brand isn't what we tell consumers. Our brand is what consumers tell each other.
Pause, rewind, 5 seconds,
okay.
Say that again.
Our brand used to be what we told consumers. Today, our brand is what consumers tell each other. Mm. And this was like the moment when I thought, well, really, the brand is becoming part of that conversation. Being in marketing today is being invited to that conversation. And one of the, a part of the cataclysmic change is we can't buy our way in. We have to be invited into this conversation.
That makes it extremely empowering for us as consumers.
Yes.
And as a business,
absolutely,
it means that we have to find ways to play along. So who's a prime example of a company that has seen this and gone, they're driving the conversation, we're jumping in with them?
Yeah. My favorite company right now, how many have heard of Glossier? Glossier.
Woo! Is it a French company?
We've got a few. Woos.
Glossier.
Glossier. Glossier is, you. If you're not familiar with them, you would love this company. It was founded by Emily Weiss. Emily Weiss was a blogger. And she was, she started her blog and she was getting comments on her blog about what people didn't like about the cosmetic and skincare industry. And she said, well, I can kind of solve those. So she started her own company, and her brand was, I want to create a company that doesn't talk down to you. I want to create a company that's your friend. And this whole company was built from social media up. And if you want to see a company that's doing it great, it's Glossier. They're an amazing company. And what Emily says, she's in the content marketing business. Every time she ships out a product, that's her content. She ships it in this pink bubble wrap that's a perfect background for Instagram. She has stickers in there. And it's not unusual for Emily herself to jump into the comment section on their Facebook page or on Instagram and talk to people and connect with people. So I love Glossier right now. I think that is an amazing example of a company that's built on the human conversation. Emily says 100% of her sales come from word of mouth marketing. She realizes her customers are the marketing department. That's the mindset we need today. The customers are the marketing department.
So
how do we help them do their jobs?
If I look at Glossier's social profiles, how much actual selling will I see in their marketing?
Well, a little bit, but the thing that's different and subtle is when Glossier runs some sort of ads or program, all the models, all the advocates are their real customers. And the customers just love this company so much that it's a great honor to be featured. And that's another thing I love about this company is they make the customers the hero of the stories. Too much of our content today, we're focused on what's the arc of our story, what's our why, and people really don't care. They care about themselves. We need to be focused on the arc of the customer's story, and that's what Emily is doing with her company, and one of the reasons I love it so much. I love what she's doing.
Do you feel like as marketers that we just overthink this process of selling then? Is this like, is what you're offering a bit of relief for everybody who is a social marketer?
I think a lot of people who read my book are expressing that exactly. They're saying, you know, I knew something was kind of wrong, and I knew this just didn't feel quite right. And Mark, what you're doing through this book is giving us permission to do what we know what was right. And I think a good place to start is to think about what is it like for you as a customer? And we need to stop doing what people hate, and we need to do what people love. And the first place to start is to think about what do I love as a customer? Because we're all customers. And we need to put ourselves in that role and stop talking down to people and include people. And we need to take a human-centered approach to marketing.
So Glossier was a newer brand.
Yes.
And they did their marketing in this form great from the start. What about a major brand that we would all recognize that has successfully pivoted to this type of consumer-driven marketing? Somebody dropped the beat.
Well, I'll tell you, Joel, you know, it's, I was at this conference in New York, and there was someone up there giving a presentation about this human-centered marketing, about instead of an advertising-centered approach, taking this human-centered approach, and they asked this person, how will these big brands pivot? And she said, I don't know. It's hard. It's really, really hard, because we've got these big marketing departments and these big organizations that are conditioned to be working with advertising agencies, and it's super, super hard. So, you know, here's an example. So everybody loves Tesla, and their stock price is super, super high, and it has more market value than Ford, all right? And one of the reasons that Tesla is doing so well is because people love and respect, for the most part, Elon Musk, right? So the human brand is the brand. The personal brand is the brand. Who do we love at Ford? Who do we love at GM?
I love my Mustang, but
who's the face?
Yeah.
So it's really hard to make that pivot. That's why Glossier was built from a personal brand. Emily is the face. There's a human emotional connection to the personal brand more than the product itself.
And what I pull away from this is that for those of you that are marketers watching at home here at Social Media Marketing World, that means there's opportunity for you to compete with these big brands that can't pivot,
absolutely,
that are too cumbersome and lumbering. Mark Schaefer, yeah, give absolutely. It up for him, everyone. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Sunny,
thanks, everyone.
Over to you.
Thank you, Joel. I will take it from here. So much good information there. I'm a huge fan of Glossier as well, as I know some of you are in the audience. And I'm very much so a fan of our next guest. So Tom Breeze, as I said earlier, I feel like is the yin to my yang, whether he knows it or not. He is speaking here at Social Media Marketing World on YouTube ads, and he oversees over $100,000 a day on client ad spend for YouTube ads. He is a genius when it comes to the ad side of YouTube, and I always turn to him for advice on this stuff. So I'm super excited to sit down and talk to him about all the details of YouTube ads in 2019. So Tom Breeze, come on up. Best hair here, I swear. How are you?
Very good.
Good.
Very good.
I often get compliments on my hair, but I often will defer to your hair because it's the best.
You've got the volume. I've got the gray coming through.
It's beautiful. It's beautiful.
Thank you so much.
Well, I feel like we talk all the time, but this is in such a formal setting with a live audience, so I'm stoked to kind of share all of your knowledge with this crowd.
Cool, cool.
So you're going to be talking about YouTube ads. One thing that I love about your approach, which I feel like is similar to my approach with the organic side, is that it's a science, not an art. Because oftentimes with video, people think it has to be highly produced, it has to be super creative, you have to have this creative genius behind it, but you take a different approach, so break that down for us.
Yeah, so I suppose with YouTube, whenever we think about advertising on YouTube, we look at starting with the user in mind. So it's like thinking, what are our customers going to YouTube for? What are they looking for? What are they searching for? And when we start there, we can kind of really understand the customer psychology and say, right, if they're typing that stuff in, it's normally going to be something like they want to know something or do something or buy something. And if you start there and you think, right, what do my customers actually want? It makes the whole process a lot easier, because you're not, if you know that on YouTube they're going there with that intent to start with, and we're not like looking to try and grab their attention and do something crazy in the start of the video, and we're just saying, hey, look, if you're looking for this, I can help you. It's much more of a consultative process, which ends up becoming a sale if you do it right. So,
yeah, absolutely, and I think that's the missing link for a lot of people, is you can create the video, and it can be, like you said, pretty simple, giving people exactly what they're looking for and need, especially on a search engine, that's what people are wanting.
Yep.
But when it comes to actually setting up the ads and running the campaigns, I have tried to do it by myself. That's when I found you and came to you, and I was like, you are a godsend. How do you actually run a successful campaign on YouTube?
That's a big question. So the best way about going about it, start with that kind of like user in mind, think about what they're typing in. And then when it comes to the offer that you have, it's a good idea to think about, well, what's going to be the best offer for someone in that moment? So a lot of people will come to us and say, hey, I'm selling this book and it's working really, really well. And from YouTube, that's actually quite a hard pitch, because with YouTube, they're going there and they want answers there and then.
Yes.
And if you say, right, well, I can send you a book that's going to come out and be on your doorstep in 7 days, and you can go and find the answers for yourself on page 67, that's a tough sell.
Very tough.
But if you But if you're like, hey, I've got this video training, I've got something immediately for you right here, I've got the product is right here, you can go and buy it and incentivize that sale. It's such an easier process. So it's like trying to find like the perfect offer for the audience. And then it's just combining the two to say, right, they're searching for this, we've got this type of offer that we think would be perfect for them. And the message or the ad in the middle is probably 80% of the actual campaign. So once you kind of understand how to target the audience, which is like keyword targeting, you can do placement targeting as well, where you say, right, I want to get in front of that video right there, I want my pre-roll ad to run there. You can do that too. But the most important thing is that video creative. So we're going to go through what we call an educate process.
Mm-hmm. And brilliant.
So it's a 7-step process to writing a really, really good script for a YouTube ad. And we start with like the aim of the viewer. What are they actually looking for? Talk about that at the start of the video. So educate is an acronym. And so as you go through the letters, it's A for aim, D for difficulty. Like, what's the problem that someone has right now? What are they kind of like struggling with? Why are they going to YouTube in the first place and searching this stuff out? So make sure you tackle that in the video. Then go on to the understanding of the audience. So it's like connect with them emotionally to make sure they feel like, ah, you actually get me. That's cool. The C for educate begins with credibility. So making sure you build up your credibility.
Yes.
People feel like, yep, you're the expert. I can trust you. Then it'll be the A for an action plan. This is like, I think the most important aspect of this is to give them like a 3-step plan or give them like some sort of proprietary system that as soon as they see it, they're like, I can imagine myself doing that. Mm-hmm. That's like 3 steps to solving this problem. Okay, cool, I can buy into that. So you kind of explain that you have this 3-step system. And then the T is for teach. So you might pull out one aspect of that 3-step system to break it out, explain it, teach something to the audience. So they feel like, that was really cool, really helpful. And then naturally they're gonna think to themselves, well, what's next?
Yeah.
Like, if I got one thing out of that 3-step program or that 3-step action plan, where do I go now? And that's where you come to the E for exit of educate, and that's the basic, the call to action. And just making sure you have a real clear offer. It's making sure that it's just a no-brainer for someone to take the next step. And then the click-through rates tend to be very high, the conversion rates tend to be very high. So if you get that kind of the art side of like the messaging right, then everything else is just pure math after that.
Totally, and I think it's very similar to an organic strategy, especially on a platform like YouTube, because it is a search engine owned by the largest search engine in the world. People are going there to solve their problems and to answer their questions. So if you can give them that educate system right off the bat, they're gonna be more apt to convert.
Yep.
Question for you, I don't think I've ever asked this to you before, but do you find Facebook ads and YouTube ads to be completely different beasts? Or are there similarities in running them?
There's going to be definitely similarities because you're working with human psychology. So
yes.
You're getting in front of people and pitching your stuff, right? So there's going to be different platforms, but humans are humans. But we're in a different state where we're on both platforms. So if you're on Facebook and you're scrolling through your newsfeed, you need to grab attention at the start. And you know you're getting in front of them based on their interests or based on if they know your business already or who you are. If you're doing some retargeting, for example, you can kind of, you know you're getting in front of people at a certain point. They might be interested, but they weren't looking for you at that moment, which is different to YouTube. So YouTube, they might not know who you are, but they're kind of going to YouTube looking for answers, and immediately they're like, this is the answer I need. So the feeling that I find is like great from YouTube is that you're actually getting in front of people and they're looking for you and they need help.
I say this all the time. This is why you're the yin to my yang. Yes, I say this all the time. It's because you're not pushing your message in front of people on YouTube. People are searching for you when they're in the highest amount of pain. And Sue Zimmerman, who was just on the stage, she actually went through our program and applied our tactics to her organic strategy. And her leads that are coming through YouTube are converting 15% higher than any other traffic source because it's warmer.
Yep.
Leads that are landing on your videos.
Exactly, yeah. And that's the beauty of it. It's like, I'm British, and we're very reserved. Yeah, exactly, yeah. Hold a phone.
You heard it here first, everyone.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. But like, as a culture, we are not so kind of out there sometimes. We're kind of like, we will be much more reserved generally most of the time. And so pitching our stuff is, I would say, not 100% natural to a lot of Brits.
Totally. I'm
right?
Canadian. I feel you.
Yeah, exactly.
I agree.
So for me, when I advertise on YouTube, it makes me feel like I can do this in a way that, like, hey, I'm going to turn up when you're looking for me, and I'm going to provide value to you. I'm good with that. That's a good relationship. It's like being a, it's the difference I say is like being a shop owner or a store owner And with YouTube, they're already in the store looking for things, and you're saying, hey, how can I help you? Whereas with Facebook, it feels like you have to stand outside the store, and you're like, hey, come into my store, come into my store. And that's very different. And mm-hmm. I much prefer selling when someone's already in the store. It's like, hey, how can I help you? It's much more consultative, and it's a lot easier as well, which is the main thing.
And I feel like it's interesting to me because I feel like YouTube ads aren't talked about that much. And Facebook ads and Instagram ads, I feel like a lot of people know how to run those, and there's a lot of experts in that space. You're like one of a few in this space. Jake Larson's also amazing.
Yeah.
But why do you think it hasn't been adopted as widely? And are you super excited for all the changes coming to Facebook in the next year so that you can continue to dominate on YouTube?
Good question, yeah. Okay, so the second part of that, like all the changes that happen to any platform,
yeah.
I let it kind of just happen.
Yes.
Like I'm not too worried about what's gonna happen next. Because if you're good at what you do, then we're all in the same boat and it's just like the cream will rise to the top, right? And so you just have to do your best. With what was the first part of the question again?
Why do you think it's so hard for people to adopt YouTube ads?
I think it's hard because Facebook's really easy right now, and it's like, I say really easy, it's still challenging,
yes.
But it's like, yes, not easy, sorry.
Not
I should
easy.
Clarify
Wrong
that
word.
From the start. Yeah, exactly. Facebook is easy, Tom Breeze. Yeah, exactly. But the.
Please turn that into a meme.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. YouTube's really hard. Yeah. So with YouTube, I think it's tough because you have to create a video, right? So with Facebook, you've got image ads, you've got text ads, you've got kind of different ways of getting in front of the audience. And if you create a video that's good, you're in a great place. But if it's okay, with Facebook, you've got all the text to go with it, and you can still do the selling that
yeah.
way. With YouTube, you've just got your video. That's all you've got. Maybe a description, but not many people read the description like they do on other platforms. So it's the video that holds all the power, and creating video is not easy. It's
yeah.
like there's some processes to it. Like you do all the organic stuff, right? And
yes.
and like the actual creating video is tough, like, and it's not easy to get the message right and feel comfortable on video and things. So there is that, but also we're dealing with the Google Ads platform, which is like the first day you look at your Facebook ads platform, you're like, whoa, this looks complicated.
Yeah.
You get the same thing when you look at the Google platform.
Yeah.
And Google's been around for a lot longer, but I think it's Facebook's been, like their user interface is easier to adopt, and you start just going there, and as soon as you start getting good results, it's like, well, why do I need to migrate across to YouTube just yet and learn another platform? So there is a few barriers to getting into YouTube, but it's the perfect time because not many people are doing it, and
yeah.
it's like and it fits for a lot of businesses where they're thinking, right, I want to advertise, I want to push my business out there, I don't want to be hugely salesy, and YouTube's like the perfect platform for that.
It really is, and I think the fact that people are a little afraid of the whole video aspect of it, and there is sort of a higher barrier to entry with YouTube ads, it makes it a great place to go, because when everyone zigs, you can zag and find
yep.
your opportunity and probably find more customers and a bigger audience on YouTube right now if you're not tapping into it at the moment. So thank you so much, that was great. And
cool.
Now we're gonna go to the opposite end of the spectrum, and Joel Kahn is gonna dive into Facebook ads with Amanda Bond. So let's hand it over to them.
And we're back from the left side of the stage. Everybody having a good time here at Social Media Marketing World? Fantastic. Glad that y'all are here, and welcome to all of you watching at home. Please be sure to like, comment, and share. I have with me a Facebook advertising news correspondent for the Social Media Marketing Talk Show. She's a HubSpot Academy instructor, and Entrepreneur Magazine of record calls her a Facebook advertising genius. I call her Amanda Bond. Please welcome her. Hi, Amanda.
Hello. You're already scaring me. What's going on with this
So this
stuff
is
here?
What Do You Meme, the game. And here we have the queen.
Okay.
This the queen. You can hold that and show that to the audience there. She's in her raincoat. And you have to tell me which of these three best describe this photo. I have removed the inappropriate ones.
Okay, fair. I'm Canadian, so I'm part of the Commonwealth. So I have to do my girl good.
Okay.
Right now.
Okay, this is what it's about then.
Okay.
When you find 11 McNuggets in your 10-piece meal, when you called shotgun, but the back seat ends up being way more lit, and when your friends are all starting to have kids, but you can't manage to keep a cactus alive.
Well, let's go with the middle one? That back seat.
When you
is
called
lit.
Shotgun, but the back seat ends up being way more lit.
Yeah.
True story. All right, let's jump into this. There's actually a couple topics I want to talk about. Facebook being one of them. But first, I want to talk about this vendetta you have against Lamborghinis.
Okay, it's not a vendetta, but as a Facebook advertising strategist, I see it time and time again where people are using these luxury items like Lambos, like jets, posing with them, maybe just renting it for a day or being on a small trip with it, and then turning it into Facebook ads to tell us their like seven-step system of how you too can be a baller that owns a Lambo. So I kind of have a vendetta against playing the game that way.
Have you ever been in a Lambo?
Once
you've been in a Lambo, then you might feel you have a name for it though.
Yeah, I call these guys bro marketers. Mm-hmm. And let's just be clear, bro marketing actually doesn't just mean men. So ladies, you are not immune to this term. Bro marketing just basically means it's very egocentric, sales driven, like push the sale at all costs. And it really just doesn't lift up customers and put them first as the evangelist of what we're doing.
So like you're talking about the guy that's like, I'm here in my garage with my Lambo.
Not to name any names.
Yeah. Yeah, whose name may rhyme with Lai Topaz.
Yeah, about the bookshelves and the books that
yeah,
we have going on.
Yeah, because I can read a zillion books all at once.
Yeah.
Do you think that type of marketing, there's certain groups of people that are just susceptible to it?
I mean, there's a lot of easy promises that are made in advertising today, and who we're learning from is a small group of people, right? Internet marketing is a small world. You are here at Social Media Marketing World, and you start to see people that are showing up at the different events, that are speaking at different conferences, that you're learning from online. So it's actually quite a small pool of people. But this pool is a little bit muddied with some spammy style of tactics. Again, like pushing the sale at all costs, having deadline timers and false urgency, and like telling people that your automated webinar is live and that there's limited seats along the way, right? That kind of marketing, it's hurting the rest of us because it's positioning what we do and discounting the process of mastery.
What you said though was false urgency, right? Because there can be real urgency. I came up in the internet marketing realm. I know many of these people and I've seen what they can do and what they have done. And a lot of them have taken what they've learned from Robert Cialdini's book on influence, which is incidentally one of the best books that marketers should read, Influence by Robert Cialdini. And he talks about urgency and scarcity and liking, but it's when false urgency is like, this is gonna end and the clock's ticking down and if you don't act now, but it's actually not.
Yeah, afterwards it's still available. Or the example that I just gave with webinars, you see it all the time, limited seating, where then they have automated messages to make it look live. In 2019, our customers are wise to that, right? We need to treat them with respect and why not just be honest? Hey, this is pre-recorded content, but it is absolutely amazing. You're going to get value. There is no limited seating. You can watch it today or you can watch it another day. But if you focus on that value piece, if you focus on putting the customer first, you can still achieve the same results and scarcity can still be a real thing, or not scarcity, urgency can still be a real thing. Like if you have a cart open period for maybe some product that's only available launched live, like those things are valid, but it's the disrespect that we show to our audience pretending like they don't know better.
And the moral of the story is be an ethical marketer.
Simple.
Oh my, who saw that coming? All right, let's pivot here because there is definitely a belief that the Facebook reach is dead.
Yes.
Right, and there's a lot of talk here in social media marketing world about Facebook, Facebook ads, Facebook pages, and a lot of people would say that their reach is no longer. What do you say to that?
Well, let's take a poll right now. Who here in the audience believes that Facebook reach is dead? Let's see it. Who's experiencing it? Oh, we got a few hands. I don't see a lot of hands, so maybe they're on my side of the equation.
Or maybe they're tweeting.
Yeah, maybe they are tweeting. But Facebook reach isn't dead. I just believe marketers are using it wrong. They're using it like spammy McSpammersons. They're really great social beings on their personal profile. They are commenting and liking and encouraging dialogue and conversation. But then the moment that they change from personal profile over to their business page, they get like really robotic and spammy McSpammerson. And they're like, but buy this thing, right? And that's why reach appears to be dead, because they're not doing what Facebook values, which is creating connection, cultivating conversation, and treating your Facebook page like a community. We see with our Facebook page when like reach is down to 1 to 3%, or sorry, reach and engagement is down like 1 to 3% of your audience size, we're seeing engagement on our page of like 20% on average.
Wow.
Because what we do is cultivate that community on the page. So instead of having Facebook groups, we actually use the Facebook page like a group, which establishes authority. It gives you a platform, but then encourage people to converse with one another in the comments. So my page isn't about making me look like an expert, oh my gosh. It's about giving platform to the people in our community so that they can share and learn from one another. Because if I showed up and thought I knew absolutely everything about Facebook ads, I'd be a really bad teacher, because I'd be a know-it-all.
Can I have your page?
Yeah.
So let's say we have a page that might have 40,000 likes on it, and it might be for a certain internet personality, and engagement is horrible. I'm not naming any names. How would Joel Kalm how would I reinvigorate that page? Because right now my personal profile is highly engaged.
It's lit.
Yeah. Help me, Obi-Wan.
Yeah, well, first off, you got to admit it's going to take time, right?
I will admit that.
In this instant gratification world that we live in, where you start a Facebook ad and immediately you can start generating revenue, we have to admit that re-engaging your audience is going to take time, especially if you've neglected that page and you're doing the things that would be valuable on your business
I feel like a bad dad. You've neglected your page.
You've neglected it.
You left your baby out in the rain
Just a spammy McSpammerson over there. Yeah. And so all you have to do is start re-engaging them. And so go to your page, see, like do an analysis of what's up over there, how it's actually working and going.
It's a desert.
It might be a desert. Like go to your insights
tab. You can actually see tumbleweeds.
There's like GIFs that pop up by themselves of tumbleweeds.
Mark Zuckerberg is mocking me.
Yeah, how do you get that action over on your Facebook page? But go look at the insights. If you even have like a little bit of engagement, ask yourself, what are you doing differently from those posts? And then start encouraging people to interact. It's gonna take time. Start asking open-ended questions. Start asking other people to share about their expertise in context of what you do. Like Facebook down last week, right? It goes down and everyone wants to be the expert on why it goes down and why you need to flip over to other platforms, because they want to claim that leadership. Take the opposite approach. Don't be the expert on your Facebook page. Invite your community to show up and tell you what they're going to do. Like, encourage them to start thinking through the process, because that process then gets them commenting on the page, which sends a signal to the algorithm that, okay, that post was relevant. Then you do what I call engagement looping. You leave one comment back, which is like a celebration of them even engaging with your content. Like, yo, thanks for showing up. I really appreciate you being here. Then I do a second comment, which I literally just drop some emojis or a GIF, because why not, right? And then you do a third comment where you actually ask an open-ended question back to them. Mm. So now you post your post, that first signal, their comment, shows Facebook it's relevant one time. Your first comment shows it's relevant a second time. Your second comment shows it's relevant a third time, and then the third is now four times as relevant as before. But then you also like their comment, and then hopefully they come and like your three comments, That's now 8 times as relevant to the algorithm because it's sending signals. And then hopefully they come back and engage.
I have so many more questions, but we're out of time. Ladies and gentlemen, Amanda Bond. Thank you, Amanda. You're the best. And welcome back, Ms. Sunny Leonarduzzi. Sunny, come on out here.
Well, that was value-packed.
That
I would
was
say.
Great. I do have so many more questions, Amanda.
I know, so
come
do
back.
I.
Come back.
I was like the relevancy on top of the relevancy.
On top of
this, that was a lot.
This morning, if you've missed any of this today, then all of these streams will be made available for replay right where you're watching them now. But there's so much more to come.
So much more to come. We have some great guests coming up this afternoon. We have Daniel Harmon, which I'm really, really excited about.
Pooping unicorns. Yes.
That alone should sell it. Lots of great sessions this afternoon, of course, here at Social Media Marketing World, but also here right on the live stage. One of 11 stages here at the conference. And remember, share this out. So
now,
what are we supposed to do?
Do the dance.
I know. So
here
ready?
We go. Like, comment, share.
And the hashtag is SMMW19.
I'm Joel Kahn.
I'm Sunny Leonarduzzi.
And we'll see you on session 2.
Woo! Awesome.